evening, everyone. I'd like to welcome you all to the regular scheduled council meeting for April 17, 2017, at 7 p.m. And Mr. Collier, can you?
Mayor Lowry?
Here.
Mr. Reynolds?
Here.
Mr. Lindsey?
Here.
Mr. Leidy?
Here.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Here.
Mr. Lefley?
Here.
Mr. Craybar?
Here.
All present.
Thank you, sir. And if you'll stand, we'll have tonight's invocation by Pastor Andrew Wright.
Let's look at each other, can we? God, thank you for these friends and colleagues and fellow citizens of this fair town. Thank you, God, that we live in this country where we can be free on so many levels. Thank you for the city which has nurtured us and looked after us, for a school system that cares for us and who helps us along. God, it's wonderful to see the trees and the flowers and everything blooming and coming to life. And we ask that you enable this city to come alive more and more and more with this splendid citizenry. God, you've been good to us. Continue to be so. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. All right, we'll do the Pledge of Allegiance tonight. We'll use the flag in the back.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
What's the power play?
Wow!
He's got it.
I got one time we turn them on, and you tell me to turn them off, I'm done.
That one ain't looking real good.
I have to turn the AC down.
I'd like to thank everyone for coming tonight. I see a lot of young students in here tonight. You guys either are really bored, or it's getting close into school, and you need your hours.
Yeah, I need my hours.
They didn't want to be out.
If you guys have cell phones, do me a favor, just turn them down and put them on vibrate. We'd appreciate that very much. Before we move on, we are going to need to suspend rules of council to make an adjustment to the ordinances that are on tonight's agenda.
So moved.
Can we do that after?
After what?
After the
minutes. Oh, yeah, I thought you said before.
No,
sorry. Okay, we can do it after the minutes. No problem. Okay, so I'll need.
So moved.
Thank you.
Second.
Mr. Reynolds.
I redlined.
Any discussion?
Mr. Mayor?
Sir?
For the record, I spoke with Mr. Collier in the minutes under Becky McKenzie's comments. He had a wrong name down there. He had my wife's there. I'm sure my wife was not here. I believe it's supposed to be Miss McKenzie. No, it was not me. So if the record will reflect that, then I'm good with the corrections.
Thank you, Mr. Lindsey.
That's a joke, sir.
I know, sir.
Who made that original motion?
Mr. Craybacher and Mr. Reynolds second.
Got it. So noted, and I will correct that.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. Lindsey?
Yes.
Mr. Leidy?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Lefley?
Yes.
Mr. Craybacher?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Minutes past 7-0.
Now we can have a motion to suspend rules of council to make an adjustment to the last two ordinances on tonight's agenda.
Once again, so moved.
What's the second? Adjustment?
Oh, sorry.
Motion by Mr. Lowry, second by Mr. Reynolds to suspend the rules of council.
Discussion.
To remove ordinance 1715 and 1716 from the agenda.
Mr. Bridge, would you care to touch on that?
Sure, absolutely. These are some ordinances dealing with Twin Creeks. Twin Creeks is about ready to disband its homeowners association. We had introduced some legislation for tonight for the city. Allegedly will be dissolving. Thank you. We had introduced some legislation, like two pieces. One piece of legislation is for the city to inherit two parcels of land, and the other legislation dealt with taking some of their zoning standards or building standards and acquiring that into our zoning code. Right now, what we need to do is suspend the rules of council to remove those two ordinances We need to have a meeting with the interested parties. We need to make sure that both parties are doing everything legally by the state of Ohio. And then two, we need to take it off because there is a chance that both these ordinances will be completely redrafted.
Thank you. Council, any questions? Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Leidy?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Lethley?
Yes.
Mr. Krabacher?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Motion to suspend the rules passes 7-0.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. All right, moving on to communication. None tonight, and we'll go down to the city manager's report. Mr. Bridge.
Give me 1 second. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Members of council, members of the public, I'd like to share with you the city manager's report. Bell Manor, Clark County Combined Health District, they visited the facility on April 12th, and they are very interested in renting a portion of the building from the city. We will be releasing more information on that once we get some more definite figures down. I'm currently scheduling an HVAC inspection, a structural building inspection, an insect infestation inspection, IT and phones, and also quotes from moving companies. Council, we did release the Bell Manor utility bills to City Council today, so they have a snapshot of what Bell Manor used in a month for their DP&L and Vectren, and that is compared to what the city uses. So Council does have that in their hands. If you have any questions on that, please let me know. I will email that out to everyone either this evening or tomorrow. I literally just got done doing it before I walked in here.
Something that, can I interrupt?
Absolutely.
Something that might be a benefit when you do release this information. When you look at these numbers, obviously, it's just a matter of, yeah, well, so what? We're not comparing apples to apples. You want to break it down just a little bit and show, and I just did it myself. What's the cost per kilowatt that they're paying, the cost per kilowatt we're paying, and the CCF that we're paying, vice versa? Just, and at least you can kind of compare,
yeah.
Well, what if?
Sure, absolutely. Duly noted.
Not going to be a big benefit, but yeah, more, I mean, than those big numbers.
You can see the vast difference. I mean, we know that we're not going to use as much kilowatts for DP&L or that many CCFs for a veteran. They've got all kinds of machines going 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. It is a good starting point. I wouldn't be doing my job as a city manager if I didn't reach out and ask for those and do some sort of comparison on what we have. Now, the city building figures you have, those are just for the city building. Our overall DP&L, where our overall veteran building is higher because we've got more places that we need to go to and supply those utilities to. But it is a good starting point to start with. You see, I broke it down, percentage of what they use versus we use, and then how much of their bill is our bill is. But I'll look into breaking it down per kilowatt hour and then see if we can get a little bit better like that. Right?
Sir.
Yeah. And moving on to the city manager report, our finance discussion with our finance director, Ms. Colleen Harris.
Thank you, Mr. Bridge, Mayor, Council, and members of the public tonight. Go over our March finance report. For the month of March, we received in $893,504.60. That is a very large number. I wanted to get a little explanation. Twice a year, we receive our property tax and assessments, and that is in the collections in March, and those came up to about $490,000 of that total. So the regular amount of revenue is about $400,000. The March expenditures are $342,752.60. So our year-to-date that we've collected for revenue is $1,407,285.42. And our year-to-date expenditures is $944,358.11. I still am breaking down the general fund income tax. For the month of March, we collected $53,463.09. And the 0.5% police income tax brought in $26,607.53 for a total in the income tax for the month of March of $80,070.62. Year-to-date combined total would be $189,840.62. The rest of the report and the check register is included, and I'll entertain any questions.
No questions, Ms. Harris.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. We appreciate it.
What?
That's 2 weeks. Come on. Come on.
So far, that's what we need.
All right, are you ready to move on, Mr. Mayor?
Yes, sir.
And moving on with the city manager report, our service discussion with our service director, Mr. Howard Kitko.
Thank you, Mr. Bridge. Good evening, Mayor, Council, members of the public. I just have a few items to update you with, basically all road. Dirt patching is scheduled to start tomorrow, Tuesday, 4/18/2017, pending any hiccups with the equipment when we get it out for the first day or two. We usually run into some small things, but with that being said, we will be trying to take care of the Water Dog area with some patchwork until we get the major work done. With that, the two items that I am currently working with the county and getting estimates is the Water Dog area and looking at some estimates for Willowick and Spinning. The first two phases, or the phases where Willowick and Spinning meet each other, trying to include Pepperwood, but depending on how the estimates come out, we'll go as far as we can with the available street levy monies that I have. So over in this area, I've determined that some of our, the road is determined that a lot of the manholes there are concrete encased. So I am going to eat up anywhere from $15,000 to $20,000 just in manhole adjustments. Where in Edgebrook, I didn't have to do that. They were all asphalt. So they were able to mill around the ring and it was good to go. So I'm working with the engineer to try and find the best solution for that. But they're currently working on the estimates as we speak. I'm guessing to have them back hopefully by the end of this week. And then depending how those come out, you'll see an agreement shortly in front of you for us, for Mr. Bridge to sign for us to have the county put it out for bid, looking about 4 weeks or so from now, somewhere in that time frame. And that is all I have for this evening.
Mr. Reynolds.
And you said that was the dirt patch Willowick Spinning?
I'm sorry.
Is that to actual dirt patch? Is that actually
asphalt? Oh, I'm sorry. Willowick and Spinning would be an overlay. That'd be a full mill or an overlay project like Edgebrook.
All right. Fantastic.
He lives on the street.
Probably can't vote on it, but I was like, is it dirt patch or?
Right now, it's only half of Spinning and all of Willowick.
Top half, back half.
Not your half. Yeah.
Not your half. But the goal is to get the most the most of it done this year.
Fantastic.
Mr. Blessing.
Do we have things on our Facebook page that Water Dog's definitely getting taken care of ASAP? That is a hot
topic.
Hot.
We
haven't
posted
topic.
Anything, but I'll make a note too. Sure.
There's like 97 things today on it. About it. Yeah. And there's been a lot of talk about it. It's just more visibility, the better.
Absolutely. Thank you for the suggestion.
Yeah.
Mr. Mayor.
What?
Mr. Kitko, did you have a date when that Water Dog project will be started?
It'll go along with the bidding that the county will do. So I'm hoping in that 4 week time frame for the full reconstruction of that mill and fill.
Okay. It's another question that, again, Facebook. Somebody on Facebook wanted to know why the state was not chipping in on that since it's a state route. I tried to explain because it was in the city, which I believe is correct. So if you could elaborate to our fine audience and to the camera, and when they see this, maybe they'll get the answer they want.
Absolutely. They are in the city. However, the state routes, and due to their length in the city, we receive a certain percentage of gas tax and different revenues. Some of it is for maintenance of the road. Some is for maintenance of the bridge down by Water Dog. That is actually in the city limits. They send us money to help keep that maintained. Some of the money, it comes in as a lump sum to us, and they say use it as you see fit. Well, this is obviously one of those ways. But so this is paid for because it's in the city, but there's state dollars coming in for us to maintain that part of the route.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
So essentially, we're not paying for it directly out of city income tax funds.
Correct.
No. I think, excuse me, follow up on that, to what Mr. Murray said. I think that's the problem that people don't understand. You know, based on the Facebook postings that we've all seen, the citizenry thinks that the city is paying for these, or their tax dollars is paying for this. When I guess in reality they are, because they're coming back from the state tax dollars, gasoline tax and whatnot. So yes, the citizens is paying for it, but it's coming back from the state money that they're collecting for various fees and stuff they have on tax, or probably cigarettes or beer or whatever they got out there. I mean, I don't know.
Smoke all this and drink more. On.
Pardon me, sir?
So smoke and drink more.
I think the tax is meant to discourage that. When you post that, can you make sure to say, like, hey, it wasn't our fault? You know, we had to wait for the plants to open and kind of explain that so people know. You know, that most people think that stuff's open year-round when construction stops in December and doesn't open back up till, you know, April. So.
Somebody did try to elaborate on that closing. And you did. You did, too. So hopefully that gets out. But.
Okay. Is that going to hurt the traffic any? Would they block that lane off?
Sure. Yeah. They'll maintain some traffic. If they have to shut down, it'll be a short time, and they may do a detour down Musselman. Okay. But yeah, that'll be a separate contractor. It's just too big of a job for the city to do, even if we wanted to do it. But yeah, they'll completely do it with the county regs.
Okay. The other up around Willowwood and stuff. Was that the meeting you had with the engineers? A couple meetings ago, you said that you're going to have a meeting with the engineers.
Was the deputy engineer and myself drove around and looked at some of that stuff.
Okay. Well, we used to do that. You know. Yeah. That was fun, too. We had donuts.
Good? Good, Mr. Craywalker?
Yeah, I'm fine.
Mr. Reynolds?
No, I think I've got Mr. Lowry.
Mr. Lowry, was there a question?
No, I think Ethan already touched on it, but the batch plants are open now. That's why you're able to start tomorrow with the dura batcher.
Oh, no, that's a whole different ballgame. That's an emulsion. That's like a liquid, like a very fluid tar mixed with chipstone, like they were doing a tar and chip on a regular road.
Yeah. Thank you. When will they open?
They're trying to run some bony stuff through right now, which we definitely don't want to be putting that down, but it's any time.
Okay. Thank you.
What's bony? Can you explain that?
What's bony stuff?
Oh, bony asphalt is usually when it comes out and they haven't got all the big rocks cleared out of it. It can come out and it looks like big chunks of bones are all through it. Nice. It's not a nice smooth.
We'll take it at the Water Dog just to fill the hole.
It stands for not good.
All right.
It stands for not good.
Mr. Mayor. Mr. Lindsay.
Mr. Kicker, I noticed that there was a drain basin at the south end, south part of Henry Street that finally had the cement work and stuff done. Mm-hmm. I just wanted to let you know that I did notice that, and I'm sure the homeowner there really appreciates it too.
Bad shape.
Yes.
Bad shape.
Just one more question, Mr. Kerber. The gas company, where are they going to be done?
Who knows? Right now, they got the church in Jefferson. They completed the install. They did their temporary patch. And as you see, all those, even if they're plates, all those little asphalt repairs I got, those are temporary. Another company needs to come in and they'll do the finishing asphalt work. But that's Premier doing that portion of the gas. The Main Street was taking everybody off the medium pressure because they had some leak issues. So they moved everybody to the newer low, took everybody off the low pressure, moved everybody over to the medium pressure. From Speedway up to the Aero Queen area. So those all should be restored here shortly. Again, they're waiting on the asphalt plants also.
Thank you, sir. Council, any other questions?
Mr. Bridge.
Awesome, thank you. And moving on with our city manager's report. And we're gonna skip the fire report because it looks like he may be on a run. We'll go over to our sergeant, to our police discussion with Sergeant Underwood.
Thank you, sir. Mayor, Council, and citizens. Our March report, our new crawl deputies were dispatched to 60 calls. Five of those were domestic violence, three were overdoses, 10 thefts, five non-injury crash, and there was four traffic stops. Overall, we had another good month of weather. But I just want to remind you that every police department in the country is going to be out in nice weather trying to slow people down. It's just typical that people will be driving a little faster now. So tickets are not cheap.
And Excuse me, Sarge, can you speak up a little bit, please?
Yes, if the mic's on.
This wasn't microphones for us.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. You want me to start over?
No, I'm good, sir. If you just talk a little louder, please.
The last part of March, I had a meeting with our Clark County computer technology personnel about replacing one of the computers at our substation. This computer was used as a supervisor's workstation and it now will be turned into another workstation for the deputies. And I'm up here some of the times, but I do most of my work down at the East office, especially the paperwork. And I think it's important that we have another workstation. We have a lot of paperwork. Those that are interested in law enforcement, whatever you do for 10 minutes, you're going to take the next 45 and write it down. So there is a need for that. The nice thing about that is it's no charge. The only thing that New Carlisle will be paying for out of the substation, out of the deputy's office, will be for a printer. And we'll have two new computers, and I want to thank everyone that helped us get a new paper shredder. In today's age, that's really important. If we stop you, we don't want your information to get out, so we're shredding it. But anyhow, I'm really happy that we're going to get another computer for the deputies up there, and they don't have to kind of wait in line if they have something going on. And we've been updating some of our worn out or outdated equipment that's needed in the patrol cars. This has been needed for a long time. All four cars now have new car opening tools, so if you lock your keys in your car, give us a call. We have traffic cones. It's required we all have three, and they do. We have first aid kits. Three of those were donated by the fire department, actually last year, and we purchased one for the fourth car. And the new wheel tapes, those are the measuring tapes if you're involved in a crash that we run along the road. I can't tell you how old those tapes were we had. They were like 20 years old at least. And the Dodge Charger that ServPro cleaned out is working fine. I've not received any complaints. So that's good. That puts that other car out on the street for us. With that ends my report for tonight. And if you have any questions, I'd be happy to try to answer them.
Mr. Craybaugh.
Okay, just a couple things. So, one of the things in your first aid kit, do you have tourniquets?
Tourniquets?
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. Those are issued by the sheriff's office.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure, because I saw a report how that in itself is saving lives. You can apply them soon enough.
Deputies have them on them whenever they're working.
Okay, good. All right. Overdoses, that's a big thing with me. Does the crashes, the non-injury crashes and overdoses, is there kind of a relationship between that?
No. If it was OVI related, it would be under OVI, an arrest or report, more than likely an arrest. But these are just somebody wasn't paying attention and collided.
Okay. I was going to ask the chief this, but, because him and I were talking coming in about the big run on overdoses in the Clark County area. Is any of that filtering into New Carlisle, to the western Clark County?
Certainly is. We don't have as much, but that's what they're on right now, is a drug overdose. So we're getting them. We don't get as many as the fire department, but we're first responders. So in fact, we had a car responding tonight with the chief. So yes, that is in your neighborhood.
And I noticed that, they were saying that the overdoses this weekend, especially was fentanyl, not necessarily heroin. Yeah, I know we had the nurse here last meeting, and that was a wonderful report that she gave. And unfortunately, it's going up, not just in Clark County, and also the surrounding counties. But hasn't there been some bust, I hate to call them bust, but arrest, big drug arrest here recently?
Yes.
In the Montgomery, Shelby, and Clark?
There was just a big one in Enon last week. We are working on doing other drug busts, so I usually don't get much information on those. They work a long time, sometimes 6 months or more, to put this together, and they're not going to take a chance it gets leaked out.
Yeah, just like I said, all the students are here again today. Like the nurse says, don't do it. Just don't do it, and it's. I know you want to see your friends, and you said, oh, that's cool. I want to try it too, but don't do it. It will be easier and better for you just to walk away.
Thank you, Mr. Craybrook. Mr. Leiby.
Hey, Sarge. Are there anyone patrolling the bike path at night anymore? Like, are you guys putting a car down there or a bicycle?
Yes, sir, we are. Our new guy, it's the first question he asked. How much time do you want me to spend on the bike trail?
Well, he was actually the one that came to our house one night. There's been traffic every single night of people walking out of there all hours of the night. I'm actually on this report. One night, somebody took our flower pots and smashed them in the road. And it's just people in and out of that bike path all hours of the night. So the curfew for the bike path is when the sun goes down, correct? Is that?
That I honestly don't know. Do you know, Bruce?
I'm assuming it's a park.
Most parks are dusted on. And if I may, Mr. Mayor, if we need to do an ordinance or something on that for the city, I think if we don't have one, maybe we need to do that. Maybe it needs to be posted, and maybe Mr. Carter has some information on this.
We do have one. I can't remember the specific, but okay. May have been 2 to 3 years ago when we actually enacted that.
Okay.
I have to dig that up and
is it posted?
Research it.
Huh? Is it posted?
I don't know if it's posted, but I know we set definite times.
Yes. Mr. Bridge, is the bikeway in the parks posted dusk to dawn for hours?
I honestly don't know.
It is. I don't know.
Yeah, this section is here. I don't know about the other.
The entire bike path is, ma'am, or just the parks?
Just the sign to be coming in the parks. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Maybe we need to post some of the entrances if we could, if we have the signs for the park, for the bikeway. Maybe that would put a little more teeth into the deputies doing their job. I don't know.
It's not a bad idea. And where I see them, because I live on West Washington, right near that dead end, and that's where I see young adults mostly in and out. Yeah. Out all night. One night there was my neighbor and I saw a fire sitting up on top, and next morning went down, there were beer bottles sitting up on there. And I just think it's, you know, with all the dryness going around, I think it'd be wise to get that patrolled a little bit to really get it under control before something bad happens.
Thank you, Mr. Lowry.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Lowry.
Mr. Lindsay, good sir. Idea, but could we add to it and put a fine with it, a nice fine? Mm-hmm. I mean, you can sit here and put signs up all you want, but if there's no fine or no...
Exactly. I mean, I think we can put a penalty to that through an ordinance. I think we can put a penalty to that through an ordinance.
If you just run around and tell them you're not allowed to do it and there's no consequences to pay, it's not going to
stop. Can I offer some insight, though? So the fine, it's going to be a minor misdemeanor. Yes. If that, for $100, we're going to pay more in legal... trying to take that person to court than to oppose a fine.
No, well, I think the deputies could cite him a ticket, write a citation and force him to court.
Right, and our attorney still has to go to that court hearing. She has to show up in half of the city to have representation, because if she doesn't show up for representation, they're automatically going to win. And correct me if I'm wrong on that statement. You have to show up in court hearing so they win, right?
But it's a deterrent. So if we'll look at it, we can subject it to whatever our park restriction is. But let me take a look at it. Yeah. We can maybe use the enforcement mechanism that we already have on the books. Subject it to it, it's a good idea.
Okay.
And then we have an enforcement mechanism already in place. But we may already have everything that we need.
Okay.
We just need to give the public notice by posting.
Right. So we could possibly have maybe an ordinance maybe at the next meeting. Would that be enough time or not?
She's saying we might not need the ordinance.
Oh, we may not need the ordinance.
I think there's
ordinance. Okay.
Let's research the last ordinance, because I think there is language in there regarding the penalty.
Okay.
Yeah. At least we need to get it posted. Right. Some more sure. To it. Okay.
Now, are we allowed to administer our own fine structure, or is that going to be set by the ORC?
I don't know. I need to take a look at what we already have.
That's what I was getting ready to ask. I like what Mr. Lowry said. Why 100? Why is it, if we are legally allowed to make it 500?
Exactly.
Because then it makes it worthwhile if we're going to court and fight for it.
You take a bite out of them, they'll only do it once.
It's just kingdom.
So, yeah, if you want to dig into it, that'd be great.
I think there's enough traffic right now and enough activity going down there that probably isn't good that it's probably wise to take this seriously, and if we can't put a fat fine on there, let's go ahead. I mean, honestly, there's some shady stuff going down. Just the in and out so frequently, you know, there'll be one person walking down, we'll be down there for an hour, and then other people park, walk in, and walk out. It's like, good grief.
That could be a good place for drug deals going down.
As I look through these reports that the sergeant brings, the first thing I notice is we have a high number of calls for overdoses. And each time I've looked at these reports, the last couple times I've been to your meetings, sadly, I've seen a DOA on each time I've been out here. And when I hear that we need to address the bike path, the first thing that you need is you need an enforcement mechanism. And the second thing you need a presence of your police staff in there. And so once you put those two things into play, then you're going to be able to address your situation.
Hi, Mr. Lauer, are you finished? I mean, this was your...
Yeah, I'm good.
Okay.
I don't think getting a police presence on the bike trail would be a problem. We got some pretty good deputies here in town, and we have an excellent sergeant. I think if it's requested of him, that he'll make sure that happens. But I think they've already gotten the idea that they will pick us up on their own now and be looking at this bike trail a little more closely in the evening hours. But we still need to follow through with what you was talking about and that ordinance, make sure we do have one and make sure and see what type of fine, if we can do it, initiate a fine ourselves and then make it substantial if we can, to where they only want to get caught once down there. But if the ORC says we can only do $50 or $100, well then, you know, what do we do? We have to go with the ORC. I'm done, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Sorry I took so much time.
Yeah, I just double up on that. I mean, the bike path, I think, has become one of the star parks, if you will, of New Carlisle. We need to protect that reputation as much as possible.
Well, you want it to be a good community asset. You need it to be safe.
Exactly. Mr. Lindsay? Sorry.
I have less to do.
Mr. Mayor, we'll see you after the meeting.
Even trying to manage it. Look at him. I know, just talking with Coach Holbrook, when the kids cleaned up, the track kids cleaned up our bike path, the stuff that they picked up, there's a lot of bad stuff going on there. So it's real important that we do that.
Thank you. Mr. Craylock.
Just add something else to it, Sergeant, is that there's been some break-ins at the school, and I know Ron was there this weekend, and he chased four of them out. You know, I happened to be there, there was bikes on the outside, and he just beat on the door, and he said they ran like scared rabbits. But however,
can we take their bicycle?
That's still another issue. And while I was there today, the deputy was there twice. You know, I mean, she just came through and drove through. And so that's a good presence for it. But, you know, school needs to not be.
It's going to intensify when school lets out.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that's what I've come to say.
Thank you, sir. You're welcome. Mr.
Williams, just another thing, to pick up on what the sergeant said, the school's going to be letting out. That means, you know, historically here in town, when school is out, crime skyrockets. I don't know what the correlation is. I think we have more drug dealers or drug people comes into town. They're looking for easy money or something. But, you know, everybody needs to keep an eye on your own stuff and on your neighbor's stuff, you know, to try to get this town back where it needs to be. That's all I got, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, just to piggyback off of Bill, he's right. Public safety is everybody's job. So, as they say, if you see something, say something.
Thank you, sir. Sorry.
First of all, I want to say, if you see any activity on the bike path after dark, give us a call. Call the non-emergency number at the sheriff's office. You can call the deputy. They have phones. Let us know they're on there. Don't wait till the next morning. We'd like to slip in there and catch them. And that's possible too. And then with the sign on the bike path, if you put no trespassing on there from hours to hours, that gives us all the meat we need. Now, by the prosecutor's office, in Clark County, even though if you have a sign up, we still must warn them the first time. The second time, they're ours. There's a fine that goes along with it, and it could be jail time.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Lowry.
Can we get no trespassing fines? In the middle?
Where they'll post the hours it's open and stuff like that, but I'm sure we can cross them. Absolutely.
Okay. Thank you.
Fantastic. Great conversation.
I guess that would be,
thank you, counsel.
That would be cheaper.
Moving on.
And moving on, we're going to. I think our fire chief is back in the building, correct?
Yeah.
And we'll just let Fire Chief Trustee go over his fire report.
Mayor, Councilman, public. For the month of March, New Carlisle Fire Division responded to 78 EMS calls in the city, 11 EMS calls in Elizabeth Township. The division responded to 25 fire-related calls in the city and 7 in Elizabeth Township. We had 2 EMS calls answered mutual aid, either from Pike Township or Bethel Clark, due to Medic 52 being on response. We answered 1 mutual aid EMS for Pike Township and 1 for Bethel Clark. Medic 52A responded to 2 EMS calls. In the month of March, the division responded to 4 overdoses. And Assistant Chief Geiselman gave 1 CPR class this last month for 2 people. She's averaging now, with the summer weather picking back up, she's averaging anywhere from 2 to 3 classes a month now. For average shoot time, which means how long it took the apparatus to get out the door, was 109 seconds.
Mr. Mayor. Mr. Lindsay.
Chief, in your report you said we had four overdose calls, and on the sergeant's report he said we had 3 overdoses?
It could have been that Medic 52 responded mutual aid to either Pike Township or Bethel Clark on an overdose.
So those, all those was not here in the city?
It could have been. One of those could have been for them.
Okay. Thanks, sir.
Council, any other questions? Mr. Craybaugh.
Asked you on the way in, and I, about the post lady?
Yes.
Okay. What a lot of people don't know is there was a male lady today that had gotten bit. Was the door locked?
I don't know, sir.
You don't know?
The dog charged the door and broke out of the door and grabbed her by the arm.
Yeah. So this, if it's who I think it is, because, you know, I had 2 phone calls shortly after. Yeah. She's been doing that route for ever, 20 plus years. Mm-hmm. And so lock your doors. I don't know why the dog went after her. She's probably put mail in that mailbox for a long, long time.
And for that breed of dog, it's very unusual. They're not usually an aggressive dog.
Yeah, right. So that's something else to look at.
Thank you, sir. Any other questions, counsel? Thank you, Chief. Appreciate the report. Everything okay outside of the building?
Excuse me, sir.
Everything okay?
Yeah, another OD.
Thank you. Mr. Bridge.
And moving on to City Manager's Report under informational items. Myself and our Finance Director, Ms. Colleen Harris, we will be out of the office on Thursday, April 27th for a conference we'll be going to. Also, good news, I know a lot of people have been asking about this. On this Wednesday, April 19th, we will be having another meeting scheduled to bring online utility payments to the city, so people will be able to go online and pay their water bill. That's very exciting news. And also at the last council meeting, we had a good citizen come up and was asking questions about the ATV ordinances and also the 0.5% Madison Street income tax increase for the roof. I will be looking at researching those the past 2 weeks, which is buried with other stuff. So it is on my to-do list. I just wanted to give council and the public an update of where we stand on that. That is all I have with the city manager's report. I would be happy to entertain any questions.
Mr. Lowry.
Mr. Bridge.
Yes, sir.
Before the meeting started, I handed you 2 pieces of paper.
You did.
One was an in-depth discussion about, say the word for me that I can't.
Tax reciprocity. I can't say it either.
Reciprocity.
Yeah, I have a speech impediment with R, so
okay.
You may
be reciprocity. I will not ask you to read it, but for the next council meeting, do you have a whole lot of those printed up so that people in the audience, we can hand them out and have them over here for people to get?
Yes.
Think that is very important information about what's going on, and I think we need to get that word out.
Okay, sounds good. Yep.
Thank you much.
Appreciate
Absolutely.
It.
Mr. Lindsay.
Mr. Bridge, to follow up with Mr. Lowry, could you also put what he gave you about the reciprocity on the city website and or the Facebook page? If you will scan and email that to me, I'll make sure it gets to Facebook. That's the quickest way to get it out.
One second, let me make a note.
And give Mr. Grimm a copy.
Okay. You're in the to-do list.
Thank you.
No
Appreciate
problem.
It. Anything else, Mr. Lowry?
No.
Council, any other questions for the city manager? All right, thank you, sir.
Thank you.
We appreciate it. Oh, I'm sorry. Mr. Reynolds has something.
Just real fast, I know you've given this to us. I mean, I think that, I thank you for it. It was definitely insightful, but I agree with Mr. Luffley that this is comparing an apple to a barn because it's two totally different animals. I mean, I think that number is obviously never going to be close.
It so. Won't.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. I definitely, it was good information to have, but unless we're running a nursing home as a city, we're not ever going to get close to that.
Right. And then that was a fine edge. We had people wanting to see those.
And I would make sure to like say, like, hey, you know, we're not going to have mm-hmm. how many ever yeah. patients in there right. running off EKGs or whatever else they do.
You should look at council, a lot of oldness.
I know, it might be the same.
Bill has been around.
I'll push you there, Mr. Lindsay.
Thank you, Mr. Bridge.
Thank you.
And moving on to comments from members of the public. If anyone has any comments or questions, you go to the podium if you would please. Your name and address, and keep it down to 5 minutes between you. We would appreciate that.
Andrew Wright, 502 West Lincoln Street. Just like church, when you speak, everyone turns around. I just want to give Council, Mr. Mayor, a shout out for your staff at the city offices. Whenever I've been down there to ask questions, they have been most polite and most efficient. And I wanted you guys to know that you have a very good staff there, and I commend them greatly. The second one is, if the city has not already, I would like for council to think about some way we can honor the cemetery staff. I've done over 200 funerals in 22 years here, and all over Clark County and other places. And our staff here at New Carlisle is the best and the most personable and the most polite people that I have witnessed. And I would love for there to be some sort of demonstration from the city to Greg Slattery and his team, just to say thank you for doing a very professional job.
Thank you, sir, appreciate that.
Thank you.
I'll agree with you, and I think most of us will, that the staff that's up at the city building are kind of the unsung heroes. You know, they are the ones in there working 8 hours and 8 hours plus a day, don't really get any recognition for it other than here when someone's usually upset at somebody. But it's nice to hear Mr. Wright come and actually give them props, which is definitely due. So
thank you.
Thank you very much.
Appreciate it.
Anyone else?
Nancy Lubanovich, 505 Pease Drive. I just have a quick question. You keep talking on the bike path. Are you including Boobaker Park in that bike path?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, we should, right?
We should actually extend it to all
of actually.
If we need signage, we'll put signage at every.
That's where it comes out of your house.
Yeah, Boobaker Park. I mean, the traffic goes there too. And,
yeah, I know. It goes right
you know, my neighbors do an excellent job of lighting that area up like a football field, but it still doesn't scare some of the people away.
They go back.
Are you talking mm-hmm. about the park that goes right off of the bike path? And
correct.
All around all those houses in the back?
Correct. Mm-hmm.
Okay, because I've never seen any lights in there.
It'd be closer towards the bike path.
Okay, but they're not actually in the park.
No, like, it's on the house on the edge of the bike path.
Thank you, Nancy.
Mr. Mayor, may I ask a question?
Yes, sir.
What is the history of Brubaker Park? When I took over as city manager, I'll be honest with you, I was planning director for almost 2 or 3 years. Mr. Kitko took me back there one day. Never knew it existed.
The earliest I can remember, it was an exercise park. There was a lot of exercise, like, you know, wood posts with pull-up bars and steps and things of that nature.
And there is a lot of that still back there. It is kind of overgrown in some spots. How would council feel to kind of curb that? Was going back there. It's not a very utilized park for what we use a park for, not a Smith Park. Why don't we just donate some of that land to the homeowners there? They can extend their backyard.
My fish tank table back there and fire pits.
It's also a haven for crime because once you're back there, you can't be seen.
Yeah, it's dark.
Yeah, at one point it was very, very nice. Back there,
that was just a thought. Yeah. I'm not saying go ahead and do it. I'm just saying, has anyone thought about
right
knocking some of that off? Let the homeowners have it. No, it's no longer a burden to us nor liability.
And the city has done that before. Where is it? I forget where that was. Does anybody here remember? You should remember, John. They did the same thing close to another park somewhere. Yeah. And I can't remember exactly when or where, but it happened.
Yeah, I don't remember that. But that's good
for thought.
But what I'm going to say, they've been doing this for a long time. You know, I hate to say, I used to have a son that used to sneak back there in the woods. Before the exercise place, it was for hiking. And what's back there is the wetlands, and that's what they had trouble with the bike path originally.
Sure.
The wetlands. It
was very nice at one time, but there were always problems with kids hanging out back there.
Right.
Because it is very hidden.
Yeah. It always happened. And that's probably the story. You know, talk to some of the older ones, and he probably could tell you the whole history.
Thank you, Mr. Craybacher. Anyone else? Mr. Lindsay?
I would like to give the deputies a shot at trying to keep things cleaned out down there, or people cleaned out and the problems cleaned up before we start giving land away. It's just my opinion.
That's a tough area to patrol.
Yeah.
But
the woods going back.
I think, I don't know how you would walk a deputy. He would have to be on foot unless they want to ride their bikes in the grass.
It's a unique stationed park. It truly is unique in the fact of how you access and where it's located. So it's just a thought. I actually thought of that months ago. But I thought I heard someone say that it was donated with stipulations to the city itself. So I didn't know if any council had any vision of that history. It says since this was donated to the city, we can't get rid of it.
All right.
I got one question for Mr. Bridge. Just a little different question, though. My wife got a letter the other day from
Parks and Rec Board.
Are you starting to revamp that or anything?
Yeah, we are. I think it's a good community tool to get our citizens engaged, especially with anything that park and rec related. And we'll have advisory board and we will consult a citizen group before we do anything that's park and rec related.
Mr. Reynolds.
Following on John, like all the open boards, you think we should kind of like go over them once a month just so people know what it's open? I know we have 3 vacancies in Civil Rights Board, which as long as I've been here, I don't think we've ever had anybody.
I think historically there's been 1 vacancy. There's always been at least 2 on there.
2?
I've done it twice on Facebook. We're not getting a lot of results.
You did it in the last meeting.
You know, and at the last meeting.
Yeah.
So
I think like
it's something we just bring up.
Continue it, possibly.
Sure. Absolutely. But we do need all. We have a couple vacancies on Planning Board, Tax Board of Review, Civil Service Commission, and quite possibly the Parks and Rec Advisory Board. So again, I think it's a good idea. We'll just start every month, just mention it, and see if anybody wants to do it.
Okay. All right. After you mentioned it, I thought I'd piggyback.
Thank you, sir.
And thanks, John.
Council, any other questions, comments? Audience, last chance, anything you have to say? All right, thank you very much. All right, committee reports, another nice resolution.
Mayor.
Somebody's raised their hand.
Oh.
Is there anything you can do to black
mics better?
Talk louder.
We'll talk louder.
I've missed most of it.
Okay. Thank you.
The mics that we have at the tables are just to pick up our conversation for the tape. They don't broadcast out into the audience. So. Never have.
Talk loud.
Huh?
Be that way.
It's always been that way.
All right, resolutions done tonight. Moving down to ordinances. Mr. Collier.
Ordinance 17-13, public hearing in action tonight. An ordinance setting transfer date as provided in memorandum of understanding for Bell Manor donation.
Council, I'd like to make a motion for ordinance 17-13.
Second by Mr. Leidy.
And an explanation of this, we got our second already, sorry. Okay. Explanation of this ordinance. As provided for in the memorandum of understanding that council approved 3 weeks ago, 4 weeks ago, and it sets terms to set a transfer date. We have decided that the transfer date will be June 30th. I will kindly remind council and the audience that this is a non-binding agreement. If council were to approve this tonight to accept that June 30th date, it is a non-binding ordinance. So what that means is we still have an out. We have 7 days prior to June 30th to let them know I'm writing. So I did email council and let them know June 12th would be the last day that we could probably get out of it to allow me to notify the interested parties. But this is just another step in that process that we have to set a transfer date. We are right now what we're doing is getting our inspections done. We're analyzing the bills, and then I'm sure council will have a special meeting here shortly to discuss that with their citizen base, and then council will make that final decision. I will say that if council is leaning towards not taking Bell Manor, and I spoke to Mr. Mayor about this outside, to kind of let us know well in advance, because we don't want to expend any more of your taxpayer dollars, nor do we need to let Van Crest be on the hook. So I think this is the next step in the process, but again, it's not a binding vote. We still have a way out. This is just part of the process. If council does decide to go with Bell Manor, there'll be whole slews of legislation for them to sign off on to accept the deed and all that other stuff that goes along with the property transfer.
Thank you, sir. Before we start talking about this, I know this is kind of probably get lengthy, so let's make sure we're going one at a time, especially since she's having a hard time hearing us. I was gonna kind of go over what he had just said was I don't know how council feels about this particular ordinance tonight and if it's gonna pass or not. I think, you know, over the past few weeks, I think council's gotten a lot of feedback from citizens, and I honestly haven't heard but maybe one or two people that I've talked to that want this building. So with that being said, I think if this is to fail, or even if it passes tonight, I think council needs to really think about where they want to go with this as far as if we even need to let Mr. Bridge set up these inspections before we waste any more of our money and their money as well. With that being said, Mr. Lowry.
Mr. Mayor, if I may, just as a member of the administration and being sensitive to the hearing issue, as I'm deaf and I hear through cochlear implants, one of the advantages, while it's not a fiscal concern, but moving into new space would give council the ability to have a dais perhaps put into a new space and to have meetings in a professional setting for council to conduct its meetings and for members of the public to meet. Not that this space is to be demeaned in any respect whatsoever, but it would provide for an atmosphere that would be much better suited for public meetings and would make it much easier for the public to be able to hear, because I've recently lost my hearing, and so I had complete natural hearing when I first started coming out here, and it was still very difficult to hear and conduct meetings in this room. So I just wanted, Randy and I actually were discussing that, and I just wanted to mention that I think that is one benefit that would, because you usually draw a fairly decent crowd, and that is one benefit I think that truly would serve the public in addition to the extra space and all of that sort of thing. But you have your fiscal concerns to take advantage or to take consideration of too. But I just wanted to mention that.
Thank you. Before I get to you, Mr. Lowry, can one of you, I'm sorry, just shut that off. Just completely shut it off. Because it is really hard to hear in here.
It's getting cold, too.
Thank you, Mr. Bridge. Here to free
are you
kidding? All right, Mr. Lowry.
Oh, man.
You cut all your hair off.
We did.
Yeah.
Okay, Mr. Lowry.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. Several years ago, Madison Street was bought. I was not on council when that happened. I can't say how many people came to council and said buy it, not buy it. I can't discuss it. I was here when Twin Creeks came about. I personally, at many, many meetings, begged one of your people come and tell us what to do about Twin Creeks. Should we do it or should we not? As I remember, no one came. No one spoke. So I voted for it. I like Twin Creeks. Okay. We was all put in a position that was on council at that time to do it ourselves because there was no input. Now, Bell Manor. I think Bell Manor is an excellent idea. I think it is the proper thing to do. I think it will save the city money. I agree with everything that you just said, everything. However, since it has came about, I have not had one person walk up to me and say, Rick, Mr. Lowry. Oh, okay. Now I have. But anyhow.
I will if I can get up and talk.
Okay.
I forgot.
Okay. But, or what? At any rate, I have not had anyone until now come to me and say, we think it's the thing to do. And it is the citizens' money that we are about to spend. Although I think it's a good idea, I'm not voting for myself. I'm voting for all the people in the city of New Carlisle that I represent. And I can tell you that there's been at least 100 people that have come to me, that I've spoke to, that said it's a bad idea. Mr. Bridge, fellow councilman, I think right now is the time to look at Mr. Bridge and say, do not spend another nickel on inspection. And if none of us do that, then we all need to get up, walk out the door because we're not representing the people of this city and doing what they are asking us to do. Now, with that being said, down the road, if we have to move into another building and it costs bukus of money, I'm sorry. That's what we were told to do. Okay? I see it on Facebook every day. I see it every day I walk up down the street. I hear it when I walk into stores. I hear it when I visit. I cannot vote for this, and once again, I think you should not spend one more nickel on Bell Manor. That's my opinion, gentlemen.
Well, I think that
I won't argue with anyone. I'm just, you know, and that's not against you or anyone else. I'll discuss it with the public if they want to discuss it. But far as here, I'm rock solid. That's what I've been told to do.
Well, what happens with this ordinance tonight, I think, will say a lot. But if this was to fail tonight, I think then we need to have a discussion here tonight and say, look, we need to have a meeting soon and discuss where we want to go so we can stop any work or inspections that are done. I don't think we can do it now before we vote on this. So, Mr. Lynn.
Mr. Mayor and Council, Mr. Bridge, I think what we should do on this ordinance, instead of taking the vote, I think we should table this. I think we should have they call it a work session or a public meeting or hearing or whatever, and really have people come in here and tell us what they want. I know we've had 15 or 20 people come in here. I too have talked to people. Mine's about 50-50. Some of the people says, yeah, it'd be great because we can do this, what's your plans? I tell them what I think, because Mr. Bridge and I have spoke about this. I think we have a lot of opportunity with this building, but if the citizens don't want this, we're here to represent the citizens. And in my mind, I think we need more than 100 people dictating what 5,000 people want, but we're not gonna get 5,000 people to show up, at least not in this building. So I think this should be tabled. I agree with Mr. Lowry, maybe we should back up on the spending, not spend anything until we hear completely from the citizens, the community, and get direction from them.
That's all I
think. Thank you, sir. Council, Mr. Reynolds, I think you have something.
Yeah, I'm going to echo what Mr. Lowry said at the end of the table. I have not met, besides Ms. McKenzie now, I've met one person in favor of the transfer of this building. I've not talked to anyone. Very few people indeed are. I think that people are worried after past results. They're afraid. And I think that we represent the citizens of the city, and I could not vote for this. Now, my only question would be is if this were to pass, do we actually have another vote on this, or is this the whole thing?
This is non-binding.
Well, my question is, like, if we vote for this and then we want to back out, but let's say, do we have to vote another time to actually confirm it?
If you vote this in, you're set for the June 30th date.
Okay.
Okay? I do not recommend, no disrespect to you, Mr. Lindsay, to table this. I think council needs to vote on it and vote on it tonight, because this is a reason why. Say this is tabled. We visit again in 3 weeks, 4 weeks. Well, now we've got even a short of a window to get everything else done. This is a non-binding agreement. So I understand the logic of tabling it if once we sign it, we're done. But if this puts on another month, then now we're going to have a week or two or maybe 3 weeks to get the inspections done. I tailored this to where we're not getting charged for these inspections. We might get charged on the next one, but I have a county guy coming down for the structural inspection. Our HVAC guys are going to be donated by a local guy. So I'm doing this at a lot of minimal cost. But to delay legislation is just delaying time and money. I think it needs to be voted on tonight. Non-binding. You'll have ample time to get out of it. Prior to that, no questions asked. Before the deed is even there, that's going to be voted on by council as well. But there is really no point in tabling it because it's non-binding. If it was binding, then I can see tabling it, but there's just no point to
it. I think that, you know, a lot of people are gun-shy, if you will. I mean, you know, Madison Street School was less of a bad taste in a lot of people's mouth than it should have. I will never understand the mindset behind the council that did that at that time. I mean, it just makes no sense to me. I mean, Bell Manor is a completely different story. And for my issue with Bell Manor, it's size. You know, it's in good shape. It has to be. It's a nursing home. It's got to be up to code for water, electric, you know, sprinkler systems and things like that, internet and whatnot. But the size is the big concern for me. Is, you know, we may be getting for free. We may not have to put any large amounts of money into it up front. But, you know, 10 years down the road, if that roof starts to leak, that's a big roof. It's just a lot of unexpected things that could pop up. Mr. Craig.
Okay, well, everybody's talking about Madison Street School. Well, I was one of the reporters when Madison Street School was around. I interviewed Kaplinger, you know, about Madison Street School over in the old government building and down in the basement, you know, and when he first came around. Yeah, so I remember the steps that went through that. I remember I just threw away the plans the other day, so I kept the plans, maybe we would use it someday. The trouble with Madison Street School, one, it was vacant for a long period of time, you know, and it deteriorated because the roof leaked. It deteriorated, period. It's in worse shape today than it was way back then because of all the deterioration, you know. And yes, being gunshot, you know, I could understand that, but this is a different time, you know, this is a different deal. You can't always be gun shy, you know. I admit, real estate is not our forte, you know, and it's not something we always do. But I have looked at, you know, I have thought about this really hard, and especially looking at where they're at with the city buildings now. And I have probably risked to say most of the people here, except for us, you know, have never been back to the offices. You know, they are little. You know, they're more so. I've been to the government offices. You know, they're So anyway, and you can't work in atmosphere that way. You cannot work and be efficient in the atmosphere that way. You know, there are sinks. You know, it was a doctor's office. There are sinks in almost every office with a board on it, and that's where they, you know, keep their papers and stuff. But, you know, to me, I would be embarrassed to have a contractor coming in to the office. I'd be kind of really embarrassed. There's a lot of possibilities, you know, that, you know, like we all said here, you know, these numbers here, like apples and oranges, are completely different. You know, they have heat up high because the older people need heat, you know, so the heat looks outrageously high. But technically, if you look, break it down like Jim did, you know, it's not really going to be that high. What is on the table now really is just to set a date. One of the things, you know, and I think Mike contacted me, I don't know if he called everybody else, but Mike contacted me, and I know there was email traffic going about having a work session. My thing was, we didn't have any information to give you for a work session. One of the things in Madison Street School was, you know, we always had work sessions. We always had, you know, the plans out. We always had, but however, there was nobody there to look at. We had some complaints. We had a few, you know, and after they looked at, you know, I want to be able to have some information to give to the people and say, this is the way it is. You know, somebody talked about a profit and a loss. Really, it's just really not a profit and a loss. It's just an estimate of what it would be if we rented 70% of the space. What would that be like?
Did you say that's 70% of the space?
Yeah, let's say 70%.
Okay. I didn't know if it's 7 or 70, sorry.
No, 70. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And see what that's like. And see, you know, what would it be like, you know, to have a decent, you know, I look at the city of Dayton's, I look at Springfield's, I got everybody else's council chambers, and, you know, we can go a little bit better. Mm-hmm. I remember being in the basement, Rick, you know, of the old city building. Mm-hmm. You know, and we thought we were in heaven when we got here.
We were in the basement of the churches for a while.
In the basement of the churches for a while.
Can I enter? Can I,
so anyway, I would vote yes.
Room for thought too. The big unknown is right now we pay $1,875 in rent. Our rent in the city building has not been increased, and I couldn't tell you how long. Quite honestly, we were under their radar. We have a building that the people who own it don't want it. Well, now that they know that we're talking about Bell Manor, I've had to poke them and let them know, hey, we might be leaving our lease. There's a good chance they're going to raise our rent.
Absolutely.
And if that rent gets raised $1,000 for a commercial space, which is might happen, or it could be up to $1,500. Right now we're getting a steal for the rent we're paying for commercial rates. So that will have to be figured into the equation as well. If we don't take Bell Manor at some point in time, the city cannot keep on renting. We cannot stay in that current building market. We are sardined in there. We have no room to grow or to expand. So we'll have to buy a building at some point in time or renovate the one we have to expand to it. So that's another thing to throw into the equation with this decision that these seven people unfortunately do have to make. I would not want to make that decision. It's a tough call. But you have to look past a lot of things. And I hate to say it like that, but the city does not have a permanent home. You don't rent your house your entire life. At some point in time, you try to buy. Okay, what we do run the risk of, if we don't take that building, now we've got a second major building that's vacant in the city limits. You thought Madison Street School was big. Wait till this becomes vacant. It's not ours. We don't own it. All we can do is call the cops and something happens. So there's a lot that goes into this decision other than what if the roof breaks 10 years down the road. And it's a tough call, because one thing we're not going to know is how much it's going to cost to repair that roof 10 years down the road. What if the boiler system goes out? But those are all risk you take when you buy a home.
Hey, so Ms. Harris, give me 1 second. Is there two empty seats in here that we can get back there? Because you sure? You positive? Okay. Ms. Harris, how are your comments?
And I just wanted to also add, the size is a concern. I know that maybe we're not communicating on some of the ideas, but this council chamber goes to Bell Manor. Our city building goes to Bell Manor. The sheriff's substation that is just about ready to collapse, we have so much stuff in there, goes to Bell Manor. These are all plans. So you start combining all that space that we have pieced out And we'll be able to utilize half of it, and there's already interest for almost the other half. So these are things maybe that, you know, is working on and we're talking about, and I'm sure you've been updated on it, but just trying to get that information out. We're not just a little spot in that big building. We have a lot of spots to bring into it. And those are areas that we don't have to replace the sheriff's substation. We don't have to rent another city building, and the shelter here can be rented out more to citizens that will be in the other building. I just wanted to add that too.
Mr. Lowry.
Mr. Mayor, we got to do a better job making sure the public understands the needs for everybody in the city to be in that building. Myself, I want Bell Manor. I think in order to be progressive and able to grow, we need a building like that. And like you said, eventually we're going to have to buy. But like everybody else sitting up here, I've heard well over 100 people telling me not to do it, and one very passionate person to say to do it. And again, I want to do it, but if we're just doing what the public wants us to do, man, I just don't know how I can go through with it. So if we were to pass it tonight, we have got to get something out of the needs that is going to support the police, it's going to support the city workers, it's going to support, you know, even put that we might have to raise rent on the building we're in now. And just let people know the benefits of actually moving.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Our attorney needs to say something about that. The ordinance cannot be tabled for tonight, and she'll give her attorney explanation as to why.
Mr. Mayor, I just wanted to point out the memorandum of understanding which council entered into through ordinance and giving Mr. Bridge authority to sign on behalf of council. Point five in that memorandum of understanding reads, NCHF and the city shall, in writing, set a date of transfer to complete this gift. The date of transfer, I'm just speaking now, the date of transfer is what's at issue in the ordinance before council tonight. Okay, now I'm gonna go back to reading point five. The date of transfer shall be set immediately after the signing of this memorandum and approval of same by proper resolution or ordinance of city's council and upon phase one report approval. So that's what you have before you in this ordinance. It's not discretionary. The timing should be immediately thereafter. So that's why we put the ordinance together. So it's my advice that council either vote on this ordinance this evening, or if you choose not to, then you'll be killing the opportunity to further consider the donation of Bell Manor. Those are your choices.
Mr. Lindsay.
Mr. Zinkler, so you're saying if we fail this ordinance tonight, that we lose any opportunity of going back in a month and excuse me, and and picking up Bell Manor? Is that what you're saying?
You'll be voiding the memorandum of understanding that we've entered into in Bell Manor. Yes.
So based on that ordinance then that we passed, that we gave Mr. Bridge authority to sign, I believe it was like a month ago, if I remember correctly, we basically have to pass this ordinance tonight then. And then at some point, council will have to decide to back out of it if we so desire to deem to do that. But this is no, this ordinance tonight is no way legally binding on us to accept this building, correct?
Yes, that's why Mr. Bridge has continuously been telling council every time he discusses this that you have an out clause, that you have a 7-day out clause. Every time he speaks about this, he says it over and over and over.
Agreed. But the question I just asked you, you said yes, that this is legally binding.
No, I think she was saying yes as in...
I'm sorry, what is it that you're not understanding?
I asked you if this ordinance passes tonight, is it legally binding that we have to take Bell Manor? And you said yes, and then you gave me an explanation.
No, I didn't.
No.
Well, then I must get my hearing aids fixed. No. And I don't even have them. Well, I apologize. So this is just telling them that, yes, we're accepting this due date, but we have it out as long as we do it 7 days prior to this date, which is June 12th, I believe you said?
Well, I'd set that date for council. Give me time to get everything in letter. I mean, okay. June 30th, 7 days prior to June 23rd.
Hold on for a second. Okay. Let me just finish it. There is an out clause in the memorandum of understanding.
Right.
Okay, he's been telling you, Mr. Bridge has been telling you every time that he brings up this contract, which mm-hmm. is the memorandum of understanding, that there is an out clause. So there are steps in the memorandum of understanding. Every step that he has taken council through, or that I've been here to discuss with council, we have discussed every step of the way that there is an out clause, so that you are not thinking that at the end of each step that you're pursuing, that you are legally bound to accept the transfer of Bell Manor.
Okay.
And this is just one more of these steps. It's not the final step. Okay. It's not the conveyance of the property.
I understand all that. I'm just wanting to make sure that the audience understands what all of us up here knows, and to get explanations to them and for that camera,
well,
because they're going to be a million people watching
it. Is this legally binding, and does that mean that we're stuck with the property? Of course the answer is no, because there's a 7-day out clause.
Right. But some of these people here did not know that, ma'am.
Well, that's not a helpful question, though, to get anyone to understand that, because this is just a question of establishing a transfer date. So if council is to accept the deal of the transfer of Bell Manor, it will be upon this date that council is accepting as the transfer date. Mm-hmm. But you have a 7-day out clause, mm-hmm. which has been set in the transfer, which has been set in the memorandum of understanding from the very beginning.
Good, okay, Mr. Lindsay?
No.
Thank you. Council, any other, excuse me, Mr. Collier, if mine, Mr. Cobb, real quick.
Okay. All you're doing is kicking this down the road to camp. Madison Street School, that. They left a good city building down there on Main Street. Water towers are bad. Okay. Streets are deplorable. Now you want to go get an investment into another building and put money in it to remodel it to make a city building, and you're kicking the can down for getting everything else. Jefferson Street Tower over here is about ready to come down. Mm-hmm. You've got a, correct me if I'm wrong, $115,000 to paint the water tower on the start?
Yeah, for this year. That's
the, for the first year.
The payment, yeah.
Pardon?
First year if we went with that plan.
Okay. And, you know, that's money that could have went towards taking down the school. And there's something else you can look at. Take the school down, build a new city, go to there.
Had that opportunity to take that school down.
Okay.
Had the opportunity to take
that one. We missed that.
Yeah, we missed that. I don't want to open this up to a big can of worms. We gave everybody their chance at the comments from the public section. I know that, Mr. Cook, if you have something, I'll let you go real quick. And we'll move on. Mr. Collins. Thank you.
Bill Cook, 302 Zimmerman Street. I've been around this town since 1939. So I guess that makes me about the oldest person in this room.
No, Dewey.
Well, I take that back. The oldest person that's been in this town that long. Rules got me by a couple of years. Anyhow, I think I agree, and I can understand from what you're saying about this memorandum of understanding. I concur that you probably should go ahead and pass this tonight. However, the public's going to come up and cry transparency. Now, you're going to have to make sure that the newspaper and the news media inform the people that you have a 7-day out. I've been on the street the past couple of weeks. Needless to say, ain't made a dime. But consequently, a lot of the people are talking about Washington, D.C. and the transparency that we've been through for the past 8 years. There have been a lot of things that Mr. Cobb has brought up. There have been several other instances, but I'm not going to spend the time on that. But I definitely think the trust that the citizens have got for council, the administration, is down pretty low. We've got to get that trust back up on whatever we do from this point on. We've got to impair ourselves to make the transparency known. And folks, if you don't, I can guarantee you there will not be another levy or a tax increase passed in this town.
Thank you, Mr. Cook. I appreciate it. All right. Council, any other questions or comments before we move on with this? Mr. Lowry.
I have one. I did, and this is a question to the audience. And if anybody wants to answer, just raise your hand.
Try to speak up, Mr.
Lowry. Okay. This is just a question I'd like to ask the audience. I'm just trying to figure out what's going on. Mr. Cook, I do believe we have been very transparent. I'll just leave it go at that. But at any rate, if anybody here, have you all heard what the city manager had to say? And if you did hear him, is there anyone here who has changed their mind about the Bell Manor after hearing what he had to say? If so, just raise your hand. That's all I want to know. Thank you.
I had a question, Mr. Bridge, and I've had this one come up to me a few times, and I don't want to keep dragging this out. I don't know if you want to set, we can set up a work session and discuss this. My biggest fear, I already said, is Bell Manor is so huge. It is massive. What about, I don't really care for its location, but what about Lake Avenue Church is up for sale?
I can't wrap my, okay. You're asking another cavernous building. We have toured that with our former city manager, Kim Jones. And if you think cooling Bell Manor is going to be an issue, wait to try to heat and cool that church where they have a big auditorium and gym. If you're asking about a lot of work that needs to go into that church and really remodel, that's going to cost you. Bell Manor is ready to go. People are saying renovation, renovation, renovation. There is no renovation being done at Bell Manor. We may have to go and build something for council to sit at, but we don't need to build walls. We might have to put security doors in, but there is no major renovation going on. I honestly, like, the church is not feasible. It's just not. It's just, that's going to cost a lot of money to go in there and try to build walls. What do you do with that gym area that's 30 feet tall? There's this, Bell Manor, I think, is, it's a tough call. But I think in the end, it will work out. We just have unknowns. Boiler goes out, roof goes out. That is a risk you take across the board. But I think people need to really understand, and they really need to get their mind really, really thinking, not just on the surface with this, not just, oh, it costs a lot of money. Really, really analyze it and break it apart and look at what we have as individual issues going on. One, we rent where we are at, rent could go up. We're going to outgrow that space eventually, so we're going to have to buy something. Why would we spend millions of dollars on buying a property when we can get this one donated? And then we can, if we go out and have to buy a building for $150,000, that money, $150,000 that we were going to buy a building with, we can now put into Bell Manor to use for our monthly cost. So I think people just need to get out of their traditional way of thinking on the surface. Scratch down below that surface, break it apart, put it back together. Mr. Cobb, some things have been overlooked in this city, but you're overlooking something that could cost you a lot of money in the future. And that is, if council decides not to go with Bell Manor, now we're renting again. We're in the same situation we are. You also got to think, too, they cannot honor our lease. At the end of this lease period, they go like, you're done, we're selling the building. Then we got to find a new home to begin with. I'm still a firm believer that if Madison Tree School was not a part of this city's history, I think people would be more open to it. The work session, I think, is a great idea to get public engaged. I just would hope that everyone would realize that a lot of times, and I'm not trying to be negative, but when it comes to these things, you don't hear a lot of support. You always hear the negative about it. You don't hear the people come out and say, yes, this is a good idea. Those people are usually home. It's the people who don't want it who show up. So again, these seven people have got a tough, tough, tough decision. But I think to truly understand it and where it's going to go, and yes, there's always possibilities. We can have a senior citizen. Take those out of the equation. You got to look at it at the face value of what it is. We don't take it. There's a massive building there, and that's now empty. Do you think another nursing home is going to come over and take this? No, it's not. So there's a lot to really think about. But again, I just urge people and council members to not think so linear with this. Dig below the surface, dissect it, and put it back together. Is it going to make us money? It might. Is it going to cost us money? It might. What is the community good? What is 5-10 years down the road? What does this building now look like? We could go out and spend thousands of dollars to get these nice little pictures made about what the entrance is going to look like. And, you know, that's a lot of money to spend for this project. It's a tough call.
Mr. Luckley.
To kind of piggyback a little bit about what he just said, we are in a pickle with the water. We're in a pickle with the water tower right now because nobody planned ahead. We've got a major pile because nobody planned ahead. And we might be in that same position if we don't plan ahead. I'm not saying do it or don't do it, but I am. My opinion is to pass this ordinance, we have meeting with public to discuss what we're going to do, and we make a decision based on that because we do have the out. I just think we owe it to the citizens to do that at least. That's just my opinion.
Thank you, Mr. Rathley. Mr. Whitey.
I would agree with that. If we were to pass it tonight, what kind of inspections, what kind of money are we spending between now and when we can set up a meeting? Is there anything like in the works coming up? Like,
and we're not paying for the building inspections. That's being done by the county. It's doing it. The HVAC inspections, again, is being donated to the city.
Okay.
Terminex may charge us to come out, but there's a big component to this money thing, and it's called my salary. And I get paid about $30 an hour. So, I mean, that goes into too. Bell Manor has really taken up a lot of my time. You know, so when you say about spending money and spending resources, a lot of that focuses around my time and my energy that we haven't been able to go on and do other things because so much has been consumed with Bell Manor. This project has been with this city now for 3 or 4 years. I'm just the guy who took it over. And right now, now that the legislation is in place, we've been trying to work and roll quick to get these things done. The building inspection, I'm sure, will be fine. It's a state-inspected nursing home. You know, but again, there's 5-10 years down the road, you don't know what's going to happen, but you take that risk with the car you buy, you take that risk with the house you buy. You know, one of the positive things that we do see is there is interest from county agencies. Mm-hmm. For the health district to say, we're interested in bringing some of their services out here, that's huge. You know, they want to bring the WIC office back into the city limits. They want to have the immunizations that go on the church in this footprint. You know, and that's just going to lead it up for them to expand more out here or get some other people in here.
Mr. Bridge, has there been any contact with any of the colleges, satellite locations for colleges? Any interest there?
Yeah. I reached out to Dr. Blondin a couple months ago. She has not returned my call, so I will email her. And that's another sticky territory because I don't know what Clark states are in, and you can't, the only one you can have in here is Clark State. You can't have Sinclair come over here because it's territorial when it comes to community college, and that's dictated, I do believe, by the state of Ohio, but don't quote me on that. So really, if Clark State doesn't fight, there's no one else that can come in here.
They're also involved in high school.
What's that?
They're also already involved in high school.
All right, council, any other, Mr. Collier,
permission to speak, sir?
Yes, sir.
I got a headache.
Good luck.
I realize that I'm not somebody who sits here and has the opportunity to vote on this ordinance tonight. Or I'm kind of glad I don't have the opportunity to vote on this ordinance tonight. But I will say this. As somebody who's been involved with this town for, I don't remember how long, four council terms, planning board, left for a while, came back. I was part of the Madison Street planning. And I get a little angry because I think people forget history when they talk about the Madison Street School. Council did not purchase the Madison Street School. Yes, they did, but it actually went on the ballot. And the individuals of this city passed that overwhelmingly to purchase that building. And in that same election, the income tax went from increased from 5% back to 1% again. There's a lot of history behind why it went to 0.5%. That's a whole different history. Both of those passed overwhelmingly. And there was we were very transparent about how much money would be set aside every year to work on that Madison Street School. What happened was, is that project died a slow death from the two individuals who were actually the key players in the purchase of that school. So council put that on the ballot. It passed. I had actually been through, I'm trying to keep track of all of them, three city building attempts before that. We can all name them. The old building, renovate the old building, Tayton. What am I missing? I'm missing one here.
Medical building, Tayton.
Yeah, one of the stores downtown was a topic for a while. The issue is, does this city want a new city building? That is the issue, and that's what you have to consider. Do you want to go through this again? Now, my opinion is Bell Manor is the best building we've ever had an opportunity to get. I mean, it is the best. Somewhat. Yes. But it's the best, but as council members, and take my advice on this, your decision needs to be based on what the people want. Because if you do not do it that way, you're just going to have a battle. It's going to be third or fourth and maybe the fifth battle in the last 30 years on whether or not the people of this town want a city building. I heard somebody in the audience say, tear down Madison School and build a new city building. You're going to have the same discussions and the same arguments if that was to occur. So it has to be based on, do you want to do this? Based on what the citizens want. If citizens don't want it, I here we go again.
All right, Mr. Collier, thank you, sir.
Thank you.
We're calling for the vote.
Can I have just a second?
One
second.
A little bit longer.
Two.
I just like to add something to what Gene said. It was on the ballot to buy the Madison Street property. Something else was, there was a city manager who had told council and told the public that he had people inspect the building, check it, and it was good to go and could be reconditioned and taken care of with no problem.
Yeah.
And with that city manager that left, $800,000 already left with him as well, okay, that left the city that he, to this day, no one knows where. But it went away when he went away, so I just wanted to put that in.
Thank you, sir. The vote, please.
Ready for the
call?
Vote?
Yes.
Council?
Excuse me. You do have a member of the audience raising their hand. I didn't know if you saw it.
Yes.
Is
it possible to put this issue on the ballot so everyone can vote?
No.
No.
Time-wise,
it's too late.
All right. Mr. Collier.
Okay. I originally had the motion by Mr. Krabacher and a second by Mr. Lighty. Mr. Rittenhouse.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear.
Yes.
Okay, but I didn't hear you called. I'm sorry. Okay.
It's okay.
Okay. I apologize. Once again, I think it's the thing to do. I understand what you've all said about this, but I've made up my mind. I'm voting no through this whole process. I think cities are missing an opportunity for that building, but my mind's made up, and that's what I've got to do. That's what I've been told to do. And my answer to this is no.
Mr. Leslie?
Yes.
Mr. Krabach?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
I stress that I'm going to vote yes for this with the option, not option, that we get a meeting, even though we've talked about this over and over and over. We get one more work session ASAP, so everyone has one more chance to voice their concern.
I have several. Okay.
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
No.
Mr. Lindsay?
No.
Mr. Lighty?
It's happened to me twice now.
welcome to my call.
I'm going yes. Like I said, with the opportunity for everybody to come back in, please know that we can veto. So, but yes.
Ordinance 17-13 passes 4-3. Give me a second, Mayor.
Yes, sir.
Ordinance 17-14, public hearing in action tonight, an ordinance providing authority for proclamations.
Mr. Mayor. I move we approve ordinance 17-14.
Second.
I have a second from Mr. Lethley.
Got a word.
That's what I'm doing. Hey, give me some
time. Roll. Thank you, sir. Just a quick explanation of this ordinance is just basically to kind of outline proclamations and how they should be done and what reasons they shouldn't be done and be done in a council meeting. Just kind of a general policy of how proclamations are to be covered. Council, any questions or comments? Mr. Collier.
Mr. Krabacher?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Lighty?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Lethley?
Yes, sir.
Ordinance 17-14 passes 7-0.
Thank you, sir. Okay. So we are skipping over the two that we removed. Moving to other business,
go ahead.
You got something?
Well, we talked about we need to have a work session.
Correct.
We do that in other business.
That's what we were.
That. Yeah, that's where I thought we were.
Oh, right. Okay. Well, yeah, we're another business. I've got something I want to
okay.
go over.
Sorry.
Go.
No.
You can.
Yeah, Mr. Lethley, go ahead. I'll go after you.
No,
I'll jump in there. Go ahead. Let me jump in there.
Hold on. No. Hold on. Wait. Mr. Lethley.
Because he's going to ask the same thing.
John. Hold on, John. Mr. Lethley, go ahead.
We talked and we have to have the necessity of having a work session to discuss that. And I think we need to set that right now, if we can, if that's possible. And
if you're going to have it here, I suggest, honestly, we can either do it through email because we don't have the shelter house availability.
Okay.
Because I hate to set it for a night that somebody's already rented the shelter house.
That's
we can divert to the fire station, but I think that this might have a large turnout.
Yeah.
So we're going to want this. School. I'm not trying to overstep my boundary, but.
The school's a great idea.
I think maybe the auditorium at the high school would probably be sufficient, or junior high
cafeteria. Yeah, probably be more accessible to the new club people if we work that out.
If we could get the what is the name of the school?
Elementary school.
Yeah.
Elementary. Could you look into that?
Sure. Right.
And then, like.
And then we'll, if we get the date ironed out, check the city's Facebook page and all the councilmen's pages for that date. Fair enough?
Well, you want me to check what?
The school.
New Paul Elementary.
No, I know, I got that, but then you said check the individual Facebook page.
No, I said once we get the date set, check the city page for them.
Oh, I thought you for me to go check your Facebook page.
No. Yeah, could you check my
I'm not doing that. Check my Facebook. Okay, got it.
Look, I don't have one.
The public check the city Facebook page in the coming days and your accountant pages if you're friends with that.
Would you anticipate what kind of time period?
I would assume an evening.
A week. Mr. Reynolds comes from Columbus, so
right.
What time's best for you, sir?
I can do 6:30.
6:30,
yeah.
7? Okay. And that's New Carlisle Elementary, right?
Correct.
That's what I'm saying. In what kind of a time period do you think we're going to be able to do? A week from now?
Hopefully within a week or so.
Whatever their schedule really
is. Can we get it done this week?
Probably
not. It's up to the school. We don't
know. Probably. This is all dependent on the school schedule.
Yeah.
I'm out Thursday for another day.
Plus we have to notify.
Plus you got to notify all
that's
that.
True.
Plus you got to then.
So we're looking at next week.
I have a BZA meeting the 26th at 5:30, so that day's out if you want me to be at this hearing. Thursday the 27th, we're at that conference. We have intergovernmental meeting on the 24th. So it might be 2 weeks out. It could be 3 weeks out.
Okay.
The quicker, the better.
Yeah, we'll get it as soon as possible. But a large part of this depends on what's availability.
Yeah, right.
I mean, that's hurdle number
one. Shoot next week, and hopefully that's as far as we can go.
But we do have to notify it. We have to probably do it at least a week.
I think we have to do a week.
Yeah.
So you're probably talking to
Thursday. You probably want
news. You want to call on Wednesday?
It depends.
It's only once a week.
You good, Mr. Roth?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
I didn't
mean to break oil.
Okay, I'm going to bring something up that I've been debating about talking about tonight. I didn't tell anybody I was going to bring this up. I mean, I had to, but under other business, I want to talk about trash. And I know that this has been a big issue also in town, and with people upset about one contracting company in town. You know, they think that we should be able to have multiple trash companies. That one I don't agree with. I think we need to stick with one contract company. It just makes it simpler and easier for everyone in the city. But as the past couple of weeks, I've had a handful of people that own businesses, and I'm talking multiple ones here in town, that have asked me why they should have to have a house, a contract at their house with waste management when they do have a dumpster at, business A, B, and C on Main Street, and they take their trash to that business. And the more I've let that stew, I do think that needs to be looked at. I'm not saying that's going to need to be changed, but I think it at least deserves a discussion with council and citizens. I'm not saying that it is the way to go or isn't the way to go, but I think to those business owners that have to, get trash service when all these years they've been using their dumpster at their business, I think we owe it to them to at least discuss it. That is just my opinion. I don't know how the rest of these council members feel. I have not discussed it with them. So with that being said, I don't know if we would like to have another work session on that, or how we want to handle that. If we want to...
If we tell people we're going to have talk trash and the school, you might get a lot of people there.
So,
can I,
Mr. Bridge?
Let me ask, how is council legally going to say, all right, the current contract states, what they're trying to do is we have the contract that we have to trash. Single family, double family homes on that contract. We've got some people in town that own a business, and they take their trash to their business. So they feel as though they shouldn't have to have the trash contract with the city because they live in a single family. Here's my concern with that.
Did you just tell me right? I thought something's wrong there.
No. I mean, basically what it is, you have business owners who don't want to pay the monthly trash bill for their private residence.
Okay.
And that's what it is. You can catch up.
We should not name who this is.
No, we're not going to name who this is, but it's multiple businesses. I feel for them, I really do. But at the same time, the contract's already been written. It's in our ordinances the way it is. The moment that you start giving special privileges because this person owns a business, there's going to be somebody saying, well, I haul my trash away. I take it to my kid's house who lives outside the city limits. So at one point in time, is it going to be not addressed? To me, my opinion is you keep it the way it is. Because every time you give somebody a chance to deviate what you got, somebody else is going to have another reason as to why they should not be on the trash contract. Mm-hmm. I feel for those people who are business owners into this town, but at the same time, they're also residents who have a single family or double family home in this city. Those are the rules. Council already approved that through the contract. But again, my concern is once you give this group a special privilege, the next group is going to want a special privilege, then the next group is going to want a special privilege. If council's going to change anything, they need to change the ordinance to say, just get your own trash provider. Council has foregone the franchise fee, so it's actually costing us. We're not making any money off of it. So my advice is just change the ordinance to allow people to get their own trash hauler. But what's going to happen is people aren't going to get a trash hauler.
Yeah, that's right.
Trash is going to be in the backyard.
Right.
You know, so.
Oh, and I've got a house around the corner for me that's, I can't remember the address, and you probably would know if I mentioned it. It's got trash on the side of their house. They never have the trash picked up. Like I said, I'm not saying that this is the way to go, but my thought is, and I heard this suggestion, and it could probably use fine-tuning, but if you were to say, let's say John Smith has this business, and he gets a permit, say, from the city, and I'm just thinking out loud, he gets a permit from the city, it's $5, he pays it for the year, but at the same time, anybody that has a permit, they're also held to a very strict rule. Let's say the city code enforcer finds out, well, they're not getting rid of their trash the way they should be and the way they are agreeing to by that permit. Now they get a huge fine on top of it. And they can pull, you know, and like I said, I'm just thinking out loud here. That's just something that I was thinking of. I don't want to change the contract with Waste Management because the rule is in our ordinance, is correct. It's not with.
This sounds like something that we should probably deal with administratively. Let me discuss this with Randy, and this might be best dealt with by an administrative action, maybe a letter to a warning letter or something. I feel like this is something that we should talk about and offline. And
well, I don't mind you guys talking about it, but
we want to know about it.
It may require some. Well, it just may require some enforcement. I'm not saying that you can't talk about it, but I'm just saying we should talk about this, and it may require some enforcement action or something.
One question.
Mr. Lauer.
One question. How much does a business owner pay for trash?
I have no idea. Business owners are responsible for their own trash.
I'm saying is it quite a bit more than the residential?
Oh, absolutely. I have no idea. Oh,
yeah. Well, then he is not, I don't believe he's getting a special permit. I believe he's getting banged twice. For someone else to say, well, he's not paying for trash. He certainly is paying trash. He's paying more than any residential area in the city.
But this person also owns a home. And the moment you give that group an exclusion from the contract, the next group in who is not a business owner,
Yeah, he is, because the contract says every resident is going to have that.
In a single family dwelling house. So the next person who
comes in. Well,
but there needs to be a clause put in there if he's a business owner. He's also paying more taxes.
That's his point.
And he's paying more for trash.
Everybody's going to have a clause. Yeah.
So basically, what's going to happen is I got like 52 voicemails from the letter that went out.
Okay.
You live in a city. I mean, trash removal is part of one of the concepts. If you own a business and you live in the city, you're going to have to remove the trash. I mean, that's just how it is. I feel for everyone in the room. Our trash rates are very, very aggressively cheap. But again, because I filled in a bunch of calls, well, I'm 90 years old and I have my son come pick up my trash and he takes it to his house. So that's the next thing. So the next thing is, well, I don't produce enough. So the more that you give these people exceptions, and I'll be honest with you, out of all the phone calls I talked to, there's only two of them that were business owners who lived in the town. That's just my personal opinion.
Mr. Bridge, once again, I'm not saying to change. I just said I thought it deserved a discussion, more or less. Mr. Lindsay.
And while you're having that discussion, Mr. Mayor, we'll throw something else on your plate. I talked to a gentleman the other day, and I mentioned it to Mr. Bridge. He said he hasn't had any phone calls, but he's a snowbird. He goes to Florida every winter. He's gone 6 months a year. Yeah. And apparently we have a couple of 100 or 300 people that does that.
My neighbor's not home yet.
That's the grass needs cut. but those are the other people. I mean, I've talked to a couple like that now, and I don't have an answer for them. Yeah. All I can say is that I'm telling them, maybe we can look at it when the next contract comes up, because if we void this contract and we change this contract, and correct me if I'm wrong, Mr. Bridge, it's going to cost this city approximately $125,000 to $150,000.
I don't know where you got that. I
thought you gave that. Maybe I was dreaming it then. But that's the figure I have heard that it's going to cost us to get out of this contract.
Okay.
That's a lot of money. We can't do that.
We have no clue how much it would cost. What the risk you run is we have an out of that contract. If we feel as though they're not doing their service, we can get out. We don't get out because our citizens don't like the contract. That's not an out clause. So what happens is we leave for terms that are not in the agreement, and then Waste Management sues us for the money that they lost over the course of the 3 or 4 years of having that contract.
Okay.
If council wants to go that route, they can go that route. I work at the discretion of you. But again, we have a very solid, very, very solid waste contractor. Waste management pricing is very aggressive. We saw what Runke brought back to us. Waste management and Runke were the only two that gave bids. Why are we changing this for such a very disgusting changing here for such a small amount of the population?
I agree with Mr. the Mayor. We're not advocating at this point to change anything in this contract. This is for future discussion and future contracts that something maybe we could look into at that time. Now, I'm not looking at changing no contract that we currently have myself. Now, I can't speak for the mayor or anybody else there, but myself, I'm not looking to change this contract.
But a lot of this, the contract is based off of our ordinances. So really, for any kind of new contract coming up, you have to look at the ordinances first. That's where you start, because that's where you build your contract fund.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it's not just as simple as, all right, we'll make this and this and this. You have to look at the ordinances that govern trash collection removal in the first place. And for to give somebody a $5 permit fee, we have a collector's permit that you have to go and get approved from the city, and an individual person will probably not meet the requirements to be considered as a trash hauler.
Well, like I said, I just want to discuss it. This here was almost good enough for me to just what we heard already. But
it's a tough situation.
We have what? We have 3 years left in this contract?
Well, I think it's a 4 year contract.
3.5 years.
Okay. Yeah.
So
it's a tough situation. It truly is.
That's all I have. So, Mr. Collier, read the rest of other business.
Other business. Congressman Warren Davison will hold mobile office hours at the City Building on the fourth Tuesday of each month from 2 p.m. until 2:30 p.m. The next intergovernmental meeting will be next Monday, the 24th, 6:30 p.m. at Tecumseh High School. That is open to the public. And I was thrilled to read this one, the New Carlisle Library. We'll be dedicating the adult wing of the library to Joan M. Steinlogge, August 22nd.
April.
I'm sorry. That's it, August. Wow. On April 22nd at 11 a.m.
Thank you, sir. Council, any other questions or comments tonight?
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Lindsay.
Nobody has any comments or questions? I move we adjourn.
Thank you, sir.